So what is a shock? Well, it's a mechanical or physical shock. It's a sudden acceleration caused, for example, by an impact, drop, kick, earthquake, or explosion. Shock is a transient physical excitation. It's also generally non-periodic. So here's an example of a shock. Charles, you hear, seeing that okay, the movie?
Oh yeah, I'm very entertained by that.
Okay, thanks. And then this is an interesting movie. So here's one of the first iPhones that were purchased. And this is a good example of why we need to do shock testing on our products. So it looks like that they did a good job of testing that iPhone because it survived that, what looks to be about a 4-foot, 3-foot drop. Okay, so that's the introduction, that's the background. Now we're gonna get into this thing called an SRS and how it's calculated. So shouldn't use acronyms. SRS is shock response spectrum. We'll refer to it as SRS a lot from here on out. We've done that before. Okay, so the data, what data do we want to input into the, what data do we need to take for to develop these shaker tests? Okay, and this is very important. The SRS is normally measured so that it captures the input into the component. So what we're going to do is we're going to take some component like this compressor here or motor, and we're going to put it on an electrodynamic shaker. And what we're going to control the shock on is this head expander of the shaker. So we need to capture the data going into the part, input into the component. Any other structure component that would see similar can be tested. So once we get this, if we were to change out these components, we can test them with the same shock. So we're not testing what's going on the part, although if you have channels, I think it's a good idea to take some accelerometers on the part. At least when you fixture it and put this in the shaker, you'll be able to compare the severity from your shock test with the severity in the field on the part. But it's not required. What we want is the input. The other thing is you want to sample a lot higher than we do for noise and vibration work. So noise and vibration work, a lot of it is done in the frequency domain. So in the frequency domain, generally we have this rule of at least 2, but because of anti-aliasing, we sample at 2.5 times the max frequency we want to analyze. So if we were at 1,000 hertz analyzing, we would go to 2.5 times. And then that would be, we'd have no alias data in 1,000 hertz, and we could do our analysis. And we'll get exactly the right amplitude in the frequency domain. That rule of thumb does not really work for a shock response spectrum. Here, as a general rule, you want to take 10 times the max frequency. So if you're sampling at 1,000, it's at least 10 kilohertz. If you're taking the SRS out to 10 kilohertz, then it's at least 100. 20 kilohertz, 200. And the reason you want to do that is this analysis is purely in the time domain. And in the time domain, think about a frequency and having 10 points per period. And what we're interested in is that max acceleration at that frequency. So the more points per period we have, the more accurate. So just a rule of thumb, 10, you want 10, you can have more. If you can do it, what your trade-off is file size. So now we're going to cover, how is this shock response spectrum calculated? Okay. And what is it? Okay. It's an engineering tool. It's used to quantify the damage potential of a shock event. It's not an FFT. It's a complex structure, is modeled so that you've got this base, this input, you're measuring the base, and then you're modeling at a given frequency line the structural response. So it's a complex structure is modeled as a set of parallel single degree of freedom, a single degree of freedom system. So we model our system as a bunch of single degree of freedom systems. Spring, mass, damper. Okay. Generally, it's a transient base acceleration. I'll show you some. It's used in when we develop electrodynamic shaker profiles in a process called mission synthesis to evaluate whether we've overaccelerated the time. The output is max acceleration after the stop filter where frequency and damping are specified. So what we have to do is we have to specify the frequency of the filter and the damping of the filter. And then we'll get the outputs. We'll have absolute acceleration, relative velocity, relative displacement, and some others, which we'll go over in detail. So the important point is that the SRS is basically a model of a base input. We always take acceleration, so we always put acceleration as the input. So in the menus, now we're going to look at the menus for setting up an SRS. It's going to ask you for a min and max frequency, it's going to ask you for a points per octave, and a Q factor. Q factor is another way of saying the damping on the filter. Then it's going to ask you if you want a correction, and it's going to ask you for a dimension. Okay. These you'll have to fill out. These will be questions that will be asked. For a given min-max frequency, points per octave, Q factor, and correction, there are 45 possible outputs. So there's a lot of things that can be calculated. Generally, people only look at one or two, and we'll talk about those. We also have the instance, and this maximum absolute is what's generally always calculated. We have a slide, we'll describe what the primary and residual portion of the shock is, what the positive and negative, but generally people always calculate this maxi-max acceleration. And then lastly, there's corrections. So a lot of times I see no correction, but there's a DC, a velocity, and a displacement correction. And then dimensions, there's relative displacement, relative velocity, absolute acceleration, pseudo velocity, and equivalent static acceleration. We'll go over how those are calculated in a qualitative manner. So let's talk about, because this confused me when I first started looking at this. Relative displacement, relative velocity, and absolute acceleration. So what does that mean? I'm going to go back to this slide. So relative displacement and relative velocity are the, remember, we get a base excitation, we go through the single degree of freedom, and that's the relative velocity of this mass compared to this base excitation. Same with displacement. The acceleration, however, is not. It's the absolute acceleration of this mass relative to ground. Okay. So just to let you know when they say relative, what that is. And I'm still looking for a good reason on why they use absolute acceleration and relative velocity, but they do. This is the way the standard's written. It kind of makes sense to me on the displacement because I do a lot of fatigue, and basically think of a strain gauge. It's a change in displacement over a displacement. So the relative displacement, if we wanted to say something close to damage, that may be. We want to make it clear that the SRS is not a Fourier transform. So I can have either multiple time traces can give me one SRS. If I have the SRS, we'll see in something called shock response synthesis, which is also SRS, I calculate the time trace from an SRS. And in that case, I have an infinite solutions. So I can take an infinite number of time traces and get the same SRS. It's a big difference. In the FFT, it's just a one-to-one relationship. A shock response spectrum has no phase in it. So there's no phase information in it. It's purely, I take it through the filter, and then I take just the max amplitude. So it's filtered at a frequency, and then I select of the output, I take the max amplitude. Filtered at a frequency, I take the amplitude at the max. Okay. So no phase information. We've lost all of that. The original input signal cannot be regenerated from an SRS. This is a time domain calculation. That's again why the sampling, we want to have a lot of points per period. Think of each of these filters, the output is basically being a sine wave, and we want to get a good estimate of the damping. So one of the questions asked is going to be Q. Just give you a relationship between Q and percent critical. There's the formula. So a Q factor of 10 is 5%. You're free to change this Q, but I don't see many people. See it mostly on a Q of 10. If you forgot how Q was calculated, it's in the slide. We take the frequency, go down 3 dB, take the difference in frequency, and that's the Q. Just to give you some material, some ideas of where materials are. Typical automotive Q's 10, 20, 25, 30. When you get into aerospace, like I work on turbine engines, sometimes you get in these turbine blades and they can have Qs 400, 1,000. The higher the Q, the less the damping. Points per octave. This is basically the analogous of an FFT would be our frequency resolution. So it's the frequency of these individual filters. So if I have 10 points per octave, and an octave is a double in a frequency, between 10 and 20 hertz, I would have a line every 1 hertz. So the frequency of the filter frequencies actually change as the spacing changes. So it doesn't have a constant spacing. What we want to do is get enough points per octave so that we have good overlap in these single degree of freedom system, in these frequencies. Our default in our software is 6. Sometimes I've calculated it, and you can see the difference in the slide where we got the red, the green, and the blue. You can see how the points per octave changes the output. And I've seen at times where I definitely wanted to go above 6. So generally I'm using 10 or 20. Okay. So now we have that thing called dimensions. So we have a whole, remember we have dimensions for acceleration, dimensions for velocity, and dimensions for displacement. So the two for acceleration are acceleration and equivalent static acceleration. So it's the absolute acceleration here. So it's just the acceleration of that mass after each frequency. So that's a very common. And when they say maxi, whenever you see maxi, max acceleration, that means it's over the whole shock. Equivalent static, you calculate the relative displacement. You multiply it by the natural frequency twice. Remember frequency domain integration? So in the frequency domain, if I integrate, I can just scale by omega. This is done in the calculation. When you select in the software, it changes the algorithm. It's actually not multiplying by this. There's a special filter they use to do it according to the ISO standard, but it has the same effect. So absolute and equivalent static acceleration. I've mostly seen and worked with absolute acceleration. Velocity, relative velocity and pseudo velocity. So pseudo velocity is the relative displacement. Now instead of multiplied twice by the omega, it's multiplied by the filter frequency once. I do see pseudo velocity. It's used a lot. There's people that have done their whole lives on shock. A guy called Gaberson who wrote a big paper why, and if you look his name up, you'll find it, of why pseudo velocity is the right tool to relate to the damage of the shock. I mainly see people use pseudo velocity or absolute acceleration just to characterize the severity of the shock. When you plot the pseudo velocity, the green, you get this kind of upside down U shape. And the common max displacement, there will be a left asymptote, which is governed by the maximum displacement. The maximum velocity is the plateau. Maximum acceleration is the right asymptote. So there's a little more information you can get off this. Sometimes you may see them plotted on what's called a 4CP plot, which has all the dimensions. It has acceleration, velocity, and displacement on it. So pseudo velocity. So commonly used pseudo velocity and acceleration. And then there's relative displacement. This is what we cycle count. When we go into something called mission synthesis, or I don't know if you've heard of it, but we calculate a fatigue damage spectrum, this is what we're calculating it on, this relative displacement. The corrections, I typically use no correction, but if you have a DC offset or a linear velocity trend, if you calculate the velocity of your shock and you see it trending up or displacement, you can apply a correction to this, to these functions. So here's time data with no displacement. Here's what happens if you apply the correction and don't apply the correction. Ideally, we want to take as good a data as possible. Some of these sensors are bridge-based, which means they can have an offset. People usually zero them. And some of these sensors are MEMS-based and some are ICP-based. Lastly, on the SRS, we have what we call the instances. So we take the shock and we have the primary. The primary instance is the response while the transient excitation is applied. The residual instance is the response after the excitation is no longer being applied. This generally applies to a shaker where we absolutely know we're measuring the input, okay? But it's another decision in the software that you can have. So we'll see primary, residual, absolute. If you don't care about positive or negative, people calculate this maxi-max SRS, which I see most of the time. They take the maxi-max and they look at absolute acceleration or pseudo-velocity. It's what I generally see. But if you want a deep dive, you can look at the negative part of the primary, the positive part, negative part of the residual, positive part of the residual. So that's where that big table that we covered, where you can check which one you want. And now in software, it's kind of cool because you can, if you want, you can do them all at the same time and get all of them and compare them.